Right now, though, it is time for my next guest. He's an Oscar-winning special effects supervisor who's worked on over 100 movies, including Aliens, Bridge Too Far, The Omen, plus 9 James Bonds and all 8 Harry Potters. He's now written this terrific memoir, not just his story, but extraordinary kind of behind-the-scenes photographs that have never been seen before. John Richardson is his name, and he's next. And to get us in the mood, the theme from just one of the films he's worked on, Superman. Now you're done. John Williams, Superman, the main title there from 1978. And the man who created all the special effects for that film and so many other films is John Richardson. Good afternoon, John.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me on the show.
Well, no, listen, I can't tell you, because, you know, you obviously, you're an Oscar winner, you're huge in the world you're in, but foolishly, I didn't know who John Richardson was. But this book, Making Movie Magic, is just terrific. I was gushing to you off air. Let's start with Superman. So you bump into Richard Donner.
Yes.
And he asked you to do it. And you really did it. I mean, he flew around New York.
Well, we ended up flying Superman on wires. You know, it was back in the day when you had to paint the wires out so that the camera couldn't see them.
Yeah.
You know, we couldn't rely on CGI to get us out of trouble. So we had Chris Reeve 50 feet up in the air, you know, in the middle of New York at night, you know, doing it for real. And I think it shows on the movie.
Yeah.
It has that reality to it.
And, you know, as you say in the book, Christopher Reeve, he was a big man, so you needed some big wire.
I can remember going, the lighting cameraman said he wanted somebody up there to light, and I ended up being the one going up in my own rig. And it's when you're up there and looking at your own wires and thinking, you know, it's great to have done that and experienced it.
And what weird about the book is, because, you know, you're right up to date, you know, you did all the Harry Potters and everything, but because of your dad, it goes back so far. Like, you were a kid when you started working on sets.
Well, I was. I mean, if I said that one of the first films I worked on starred Buster Keaton, and I worked with Buster Keaton, and then, you know, come through, as you say, to Harry Potter, it covers such a wide range of movies, and to have, you know, been able to work with the Beatles on Help, and, you know, it's just a privilege to have experienced that era of filmmaking.
Yeah, no, I mean, every page you turn, there's a story about Orson Welles, who I'd sort of forgotten. He was in Casino Royale.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For James Bonds, you know, we had Woody Allen, David Niven, Terence Cooper. You know, that was an extraordinary movie to work on.
It does sound chaotic.
It was chaotic. We had seven directors, and we filmed in four different studios. So I used to get up in the morning trying to remember which studio I had to drive to that day.
And did the directors quit, or were they fired?
A little bit of everything along the way.
Yeah.
We started off with Joe McGrath, who was lovely, a friend of Peter Sellers. He and Peter fell out. He was replaced by a lovely guy called Robert Parrish, who I went on to work with again. And then we had John Huston directing, Val Guest. It just went on and on.
And you talk in the book about Peter was going through a bad time in his love life, so he would vanish for days. And, and also that you were quite young at that point in your career, but you had to say no. They wanted you to do something, and you said no.
Yeah, there was an American director called Dick Talmadge, who wanted to fire flaming arrows into the crowd of extras. And I didn't think that was a very good idea.
And health and safety gone mad.
Yeah, well, of course, we didn't have it in those days. We did our own. But I was called to the phone to talk to Charlie Feldman, who was the producer, who said, "I understand you won't do what the director asked." And I said, "Well, I'll tell you why." And that was it. And I went back to the set and we didn't do it.
Yeah. And when you hear that you do model work, you know, and often we know that, you know, special effects are models. In my head, I was thinking sort of someone in a very fancy railway layout in their attic. But models, I mean, these are kind of one-third scale thing. I mean, they're massive.
Yeah, some of them were, you know, 40, 50 feet high. And we had to build them to that scale because of what we had to do with them. So if you're doing something with fire or water, you need a large scale to get the reality into it. And that was part of my task, was trying to work out in advance what scale we needed to build everything to.
Was it, what's the one where you did MI5? Which Bond was that?
That was
Skyfall.
The World Is Not Enough.
The World Is Not Enough.
Yeah.
Because how big was that MI5 that you blew up?
That was about 40 feet high.
Wow.
So, you know, it was a big building. And I think there's some pictures in the book with my crew standing on it.
Yeah.
Very proudly showing the
scale of it. I mean, I have to say, the pictures are, but presumably loads of these pictures have never been seen before.
No, a lot of them, you know, I took or I had from the film, or somebody else, some of my crew took them. And I've been amassing them for years. Likewise, the films from my father's time, they're all ones that he collected.
Yeah.
So it's been great to, you know, be able to air them all.
And great to put them in a book. And prior to this, were they just like the rest of us? Were they just in boxes in the garage, or where were they? Were you very organised?
Well, I wish. Some of them were up in the loft. Some of them were in a drawer in the office. They were all over the place. And it was actually an interesting task searching the house to see if I could find where they all were and sort out the good ones.
Yeah. And because when you started, everything was practical, you know, it either happened or it didn't happen. What's it been like for you moving into a world where, like in Harry Potter, where you do all the practical stuff,
right,
but then clearly a lot of it is just, you know, magicked in, yeah, afterwards?
Well, you know, on the first Potters, we tended to do a lot more for real. And Chris Columbus and Alfonso Cuarón, who were directing those, really wanted to get as much done in camera as possible. On the later films, they tended to drift more towards CGI, which, you know, I didn't always agree with, but, you know, I didn't always call the shots.
So, yeah, yeah.
But I think you can see that in the movies and the sense of reality you get from practical effects.
Yeah.
And I like to think that, you know, across the eight Potter movies, it's some of the best combination of real effects and CGI work that's ever been out there.
Because you kind of think, in terms of practical effects, you can see why people shy away, because they are so, like, how many of those Ford Anglia cars did you need to do the one flying car?
We had 16 Ford Anglias, and all of them had a different job and a different task. Some we put Ford Cosworth engines in to do the stunt driving,
yeah,
through,
yeah,
the forest. Some we had on rigs to turn upside down. One we cut in half so that we could film the actors inside it.
And when you're watching a film, are you ever foxed? Are you ever like, I don't know how they did that? Or do you always know?
I don't always know. And it really depends if it's a good film or a bad film. If it's a good film, I end up watching the movie rather than criticising it. If it's a bad one, then I tend to try and spot the... how it was done.
Yeah. Now, you won the Oscar for Aliens, the sequel to Alien. Was that was your first nomination, wasn't it?
That was the first nomination.
Yeah. In, out. Thank you very much.
Well, it was great, because the other five nominations I had after that and didn't win wasn't quite so painful.
Did you always go? Do you always rock up, or were you busy?
No, I always went.
Yeah.
You know, why would you miss a night out like that?
And but you turned down Alien, and then you did Aliens.
Yeah, well, I was asked to work on Alien by 20th Century Fox, but it kept getting put back, and then they changed directors, then it got put back again. And I was offered a nice little film in Greece, nice weather in the spring, so I went off and did that. It was called Escape to Athena.
Oh, great, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, fun cast, yes.
Great cast.
Yeah.
Story was maybe a bit lacking, but
special effects are marvellous.
It was because of that I missed Alien, but you know, I got in second time around.
And you missed out on the Star Wars franchise as well.
Yeah, I think Fox wanted me to do the second one of those. The first one I was doing A Bridge Too Far, which was much more my meat at the time.
Yeah,
it was,
yeah, yeah,
a great war movie. And then the second one, again, I went off to do Escape to Athena, and I think that nixed everything at the time. But, you know, you don't find out about these things until a while afterwards.
Yeah. And, of course, I guess that whole Industrial Light Magic, that all came out of the Star Wars world,
didn't
it?
It did, yeah. The first Star Wars movie.
And yeah.
They really put effects budgets on the map. And it was because of that first Star Wars, I think, producers and film companies saw what special effects could offer to movies.
Yeah. And Bond, you were kind of involved in, but your first official one was Moonraker, is that right?
Yeah, first official one. I did Casino Royale back in the 60s with my dad. Then I went in on Moonraker and looked after everything in North and South America, which was a great fun shoot. And then I missed out the next one or two and then went back on Octopussy and worked right through until The Living Daylights.
And the view, was it A View to the Kill where you had to build the Golden Gate Bridge?
That's right, yeah.
I mean, that again, model doesn't quite cover it. I mean,
Well, we had three scales to do all of the different gags.
Oh, okay.
So we had a big one and a smaller one and then a very small one. But I also did all the second unit shooting up on the Golden Gate Bridge. And to do that, we had to walk down one of the main cables at 5 o'clock in the morning when it was all covered in dew and wet and slippery and set up a camera to shoot all the plates. And that on its own was quite daunting.
Yeah.